patients, cultivators, and advocacy organizations in her community. In 2015, she founded her consulting business, Brain Bloom, which is devoted to cannabis education and advocacy. Genine approaches her work systematically, reflective of her broad spectrum of experience and analysis of the science, medicine, advocacy, agriculture, policy, industry, and culture of cannabis. Genine serves on the board of directors for the 420 Archive, a 501c3 organization working to archive the history, activism, and culture of cannabis, hemp, and marijuana. In 2016, Genine joined the Mendocino Appalachians Project. Genine served as the campaign coordinator for the 2016 Mendocino Heritage Initiative, a voter initiative to tax and regulate commercial cannabis in the rural unincorporated areas of Mendocino County. Hello, everyone. I have to tell you, it's a real honor to be up here. I feel like I'm standing amongst giants, and thank you so much. So I live in Mendocino County, and as Antara said, I'm a community organizer, a cannabis educator, and an advocate. And I've been using and cultivating cannabis for over 25 years now. I work with the Mendocino Appalachians Project and the 420 Archive. The Mendocino Appalachians Project is working on the development of Appalachian designations and protections for cannabis. Mendocino County has a population of about 80,000 people, and current estimates say that we have 30,000 cannabis growers in Mendocino County. And if we have 30,000 cannabis growers in Mendocino County, probably everyone else works for them. So it's really pretty much the entirety of our economy in Mendocino County. The Appalachians Project is focusing our outreach and educational efforts towards this grassroots group of agriculturalists in Mendocino County. We have developed a map of proposed Appalachians in Mendocino County, which you've probably seen over there by the door. And to let you know a little bit about Appalachians. Appalachians are a way of communicating to the world the origin story of an agricultural product. They are legally defined and protected geographical indications found on the label of an ag product. Appalachian designations protect producers as well as consumers. They regulate growing regions, varietals, production standards, and the quality of the final product. Appalachian frameworks can also include yield limits on crops, which drive up the value of the product in the market, and that's a really important tool for small batch farmers. And I want to tell you a little bit about the 420 Archive. The 420 Archive is a California nonprofit organization whose mission is to collect and preserve for public enrichment the history, activism, and culture surrounding the prohibition of cannabis in the United States. Part of our work includes collecting the oral histories of the Emerald Triangle. And we're really happy to have Ghislaine Ball with us, who is the managing director of the 420 Archive. So say hi if you get a chance. The legacy of traditional knowledge and cultural heritage associated with regional agriculture is part of what Appalachian designations protect. This is accomplished through the requisite application of traditional knowledge in practice and in production standards, as well as utilizing the branding and marketing platforms that Appalachians provide to broadcast our story to the world. The socio-economic-political impacts of prohibition, in combination with Mendocino's geographical isolation, have largely silenced our local cannabis community and contributed to disconnecting us from each other and from our collective story. The Mendocino Appalachians Project has partnered with the 420 Archive to help us discover, communicate, and honor our rich cultural heritage with cannabis in Mendocino County. Today I've brought with me two voices from Mendocino County. The first person you'll be hearing from is Casey O'Neill. Casey is a local food farmer, cannabis advocate, and a third generation cannabis cultivator. He lives in Appalachian Zone number one, Bell Springs area. And that's in the northern tip of Mendocino County.
Some of my folks are back in the land. There's the hotspot land, 75. They moved up in 82 and moved up in May, and I was born in September, so we've been here my whole life. And we've seen the land kind of really take on a new ability, a productive ability. It's Dolan Ranch land, logged in the 50s, burned in the 70s, so it was, you know, pretty worn out, kind of on that teetering on that edge of desertification. And so we're real big on trying to sequester carbon, on trying to build soil, and try to, you know, help this sort of fragile landscape become more regenerative. And, you know, over the years, the family has done a lot of tree plantings and a lot of prepping and building of soil, adding compost, and just trying to develop, you know, get a more regenerative ecology. We store all of our rainwater, all of our ag water in rainwater collection ponds. And so we're able to use that to for cultivation, for all of our cultivation. And, you know, sustainability is a bad buzzword, but it's, you know, striving to be as regenerative as possible. So Habitat Farms is a diversified, small-scale vegetable and medicinal cannabis operation. We have three separate sites, my brother's, my parents, and mine, all located in the same general area, 3,000-foot Bell Springs Ridge Line, southwest slope. We do a CSA, like you said, a community-supported agriculture program, which is essentially a vegetable subscription service.
I've had the privilege of working with Casey on local cannabis policy. He's really well-loved by the community, and he brings tremendous heart to his advocacy work.
Cannabis people didn't start growing cannabis because they wanted to be a highly regulated business model. They started growing cannabis because it was part of their way of life and they loved the herb. And so this transition is tremendously difficult. It's heartbreaking at times. And it's definitely one of those things where when you're out in front of it, there's no roadmap. There's no, you know, there's no, this is how it's supposed to be done. And so it's definitely, you know, it's a hard journey. And you know, again, without the community behind me, I wouldn't do it.
Casey's great. The next voice you'll hear will be that of Wendy Reed. Wendy's a healer and an educator, and she comes from the Anderson Valley Appalachian of Mendocino County. She's the founder of the California Healing Institute, which offers educational programming about cannabis therapy.
How have you seen cannabis touch the lives of your local community here in the Anderson Valley?
Well, cannabis is my local community here in Anderson Valley. I you know, for years we've dealt with the persecution and the stereotypes around cannabis, but when I look around my community, I can see that things like our local Grange, which is our local community center, was built entirely by cannabis growers and paid for entirely by cannabis. The donations to our local school system. We also support a local radio station, a public radio station, and on and on and on. So even though we don't have overt shops or overt things going on around here, if you look a little deeper, you can see that this entire community pretty much revolves around cannabis. And we have, well, there's kind of three little communities within one here. We have what we call a rancher community. We have the Mexican community, which the Anderson Valley is now about 70% of people of Mexican descent. And we have what we call the hippie community, or the back to the landers. And we've all, oh, it's such a small community, we've all gotten along.
Well, that's great.
That we've never, and at the base of each of those communities, you'll find cannabis. Every single one of those communities grows and uses cannabis. So I've learned a lot of cannabis medicine from the Mexicans.
Nice.
You know, the old women in Mexico were the first ones that taught me about making a simple alcohol tincture of cannabis and putting it on sore knees.
Right.
And the miracle that comes from that. So there's a lot of interconnectedness there.
Wow, that's great. Yeah. It's nice to hear that, because that's some of the rhetoric I hear politically from the county, that, you know, growers aren't putting money towards the community, community organizations and such. And I think it's just not obvious necessarily.
Yeah, they've always had to hide it.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
How can you know that?
Right.
It's kind of funny, because now when people want to sign up to grow cannabis legally, they're asking them to provide proof that they've been growing cannabis.
Right.
I came to Anderson Valley in 96. I moved to Yorkville, which is a tiny micro appellation of the Anderson Valley, and they've been growing amazing cannabis in Yorkville for 40 years. It was a prime spot for the Back to the Land movement. And I lived in Yorkville for about 3 years before I came down here to Boonville, which is more the heart of Anderson Valley.
About 4 years ago, I saw a flyer for one of Wendy's classes at a local dispensary. The timing was pretty amazing, actually. The class was on cannabis and cancer, and one of my best friends had recently been diagnosed with cancer, and we were working together to research and explore cannabis therapy to treat her illness. This turned out to be the beginning of a great deepening of my relationship to cannabis medicine. Over the years, I've watched Wendy help a great many people in our community, and I'm proud to say that I'm a graduate of the California Healing Institute Cannabis Therapy Consultant Program.
The California Healing Institute is based on the fact that geographically, this whole area has a whole lot of natural healers. We have herbalists, we have massage therapists, we have energy workers, and we have a whole lot of people that use cannabis as therapy as well. And the California Healing Institute is designed to provide advanced education for those people and to hopefully put more people into clinical practice. Because as we see, our current medical system is failing the people and will eventually crumble because it's based on, because it's based on capitalism and pharmaceuticals and surgery, and it's all of those reasons. So we want to create something to replace it, and that's the goal. The heart of the program right now is our cannabis therapy consultancy program. And I designed that program, I started teaching about cannabis therapy about 10 years ago in different places, at herbal schools, at women's symposiums, basically anybody that would listen to me talk about it. And the reason I did that is because even though this culture is steeped in cannabis, and steeped in the cultivation of cannabis, and steeped in natural healing, the two had not made a connection. And so even herbalists who grew cannabis really were not aware of the true therapeutic values of the plant. Mm-hmm. So as those therapeutic values became more obvious to me from my practice and experience, and as there was more medical research and science coming out, mostly from other countries, I wanted to put all that together and present it to people and say, hey, you know, if you're an herbalist or a natural healer and you have not been using this plant in this way, you've been missing out on a huge tool in your toolbox. Mm-hmm. So that's why I started that program.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And in addition to that program, we also offer other educational classes in herbal medicine and energy work, and we recently started working with bees and various nice. Other things, so it all kind of comes together.
Ecological level, the social level, and economically.
So my folks live on the same parcel that I do. Mama does a lot of the food prep and canning and preserving. Papa does a lot of the maintenance chores, that, you know, the things that require sort of the patience of an elder. And then my brother also works full time with us. So we're all engaged in the same process, trying to survive as a small family farm, as a diversified family farm. With the cannabis, we try to spread the plants out and interplant with vegetables and lots of flowering plants for native pollinators, and trying to make sure that we maintain a holistic landscape for the habitat and to try to maintain an ecological balance with the land that we are blessed to steward and tend.
In my experience, cannabis is a gateway. It's a gateway to farming, to herbal medicine, to rural living, and it provides that pathway to people that wouldn't have otherwise been turned on to that way of life. And I've seen that happen again and again and again. And I'm extremely grateful to the plant for opening up that point of connection between people.
So I've tried an awesome strain of yours that I really enjoy, the strawberry OG. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, that's definitely one of my favorites, one of our flagships. The strawberry is an Afghani coming out of Highland Mount. It's an old school Afghani, a strawberry Afghani that was crossed on the OG, and so we've been playing around with that for, I don't know, 4 or 5 years now, back crossing it and making different derivatives of it. And it's phenomenal. I absolutely love it, and it's been a pleasure to be able to share it with people. And it's kind of dovetails into that farmer's market discussion, which as farmer's market vegetable people, we always felt like, man, if we could have this interaction with the consumer over the table, it would be a magical thing. And being able to do that these last few years with the Emerald Cup, with the farmer's markets at Area 101, has really been just an incredible experience of being able to, you know, share the strains that we grow and have the conversations with the patients and really sort of experience that feedback loop.
Yeah, it's fascinating because not only have I been bringing cannabis to herbalists, but I'll go teach a class on how to make a tincture in the middle of Garberville, and all these growers will climb out of the hills, leave their crops to come in and learn how to make a tincture. And of course, in each of those classes, I'll incorporate one or two other medicinal herbs. So cannabis is bridging them into the world of medicinal herbs, and it's bridging the herbalists into the world of cannabis. And
love that.
It is definitely a gateway to natural healing.
I find that working with cannabis has a way of expanding you, and also illuminating the systemic nature of life. And as such, those of us that work in cannabis advocacy find ourselves wearing many hats. I love how Casey has captured the nature of policy work by describing his policy hat as a policy helmet.
It takes all of us working together, and, you know, we've had this traditional way of life, this culture. You know, people didn't move to the hills to, you know, people moved to the hills because they wanted to live on the land, and cannabis was a way to support that. And so now, you know, I really got involved in 2014 when there was an Assembly Bill 1262 said, well, we're going to authorize 30 licenses for the state of California for cultivation, and, you know, that would have wiped out everybody. And so I, you know, that really got me motivated to try to participate in the dialogue and shift the conversation and give policymakers to understand that there's a lot of us out here, and we need access to the, you know, to the legal regulated framework, and that there needed to be a framework that worked for small farms. And you know, to me, I think this is a once in a civilization opportunity too. That to, you know, we're really coming to a crossroads where the industrial paradigm has not worked, and I think both cannabis and hemp present a tremendous opportunity to shore up the bottom line for small farms that are really struggling to make it. And so I'm involved with California Growers Association, started off as Emerald Growers Association. I served as board chair for 2 years, and then I recently stepped down to serve as vice chair and allow sort of a changing of the guard and more organizational growth. And so I'm excited to be able to hopefully spend a little more time on farm. And then I'm doing a huge amount of local policy advocacy, which is not something that I had really ever expected. You know, I sort of figured like, well, okay, we'll deal with the state and then it'll be done and we'll go back to the farm, and state regulations was just the beginning. And so, you know, developing relationships with, working relationships with the local policymakers, the board of supervisors, the ag department, the planning commission, and really trying to be able to speak for what it is that we do, and that is, you know, as an economic driver within the community, where we stand to be a sustainable part of the economy, of the ecology, and of the community, and we need to be able to emphasize the good qualities of cannabis production, and it, you know, there has to be a way to, you know, again to bring small farms into the process.
So I've noticed that the definition of criminal activity has a way of mutating when it comes to the drug war. And, you know, I think we are in danger of heading into an ugly iteration of the drug war, one that takes on a cannibalistic nature. There are policies being shaped right now that include snitch incentives, such as financial reward for turning in unregulated growers. And I'm really worried about this. I think Hezekiah Allen, the executive director of the California Growers Association, said it best. He said, "We have three categories of growers: permitted growers, those growers that are yet to be permitted, and criminal trespass growers, like the cartels growing international forests, causing enormous ecological damage."
We're seeing a lot of these articles popping up now, a lot of these stories about essentially poisonous medicine, you know, cannabis that's been sprayed with terrible pesticides. And to me, it's a real travesty, because, you know, these are people who are using it either for to help with sickness or to, you know, to support wellness. And the idea that the products are hitting the marketplace in such a compromised fashion is pretty repugnant to us. So it's been, you know, very much a joy to be able to represent what it is that we do, how we do it, and the quality that we strive for, and to sort of try to communicate that to the marketplace, and being able to, you know, again, meet with consumers and sort of share the joy that we feel, you know, at Happy Day has again been just a tremendously uplifting experience.
Yeah, for everyone. It's contagious. I really love the name of your farm. I think it's really apt for the vibe you guys are putting out. It's great.
That was always, you know, we really sought to embody the ethos that we strive for. And it really does, you know, the logo, it really came out just right. It was one of those things where I always said, like, I want it to look like, you know, like a child's drawing, and I wanted to make people smile, and, you know, walking down the street, and I'll see, you know, you're going to pass somebody, and usually there's not much interaction between men and people on the street, and but people will see the shirt, and then, like, I'll see them look at the shirt, and then they'll look up at my face, and I'll be smiling, and then we have this smiling interaction that, that otherwise really wouldn't be possible. So it's been just tremendous. The whole process has been pretty magical.
I think after experiencing and really living decades being provided for by this plant, communities and individuals have really learned to trust cannabis.
How does cannabis play into your vision for the future of our community and the world? I'll just open it up there.
You know, I'm not a big person for focusing on the future. I really focus on the present and realize that I have no control over the future, but that the most important thing to me has always been to live in a strong community. Mm-hmm. To me, that's what security is. And I traveled all over the world looking for a community that lived close to the earth and was a close community, and I was willing to be anywhere in the world to find it, and this is where I found it. And I do think that we are this strong and this close because we revolve around this magical plant.
Mm-hmm. You know, we always said if we can put a face on this thing, it's going to change the way people think about it, because there's so much media about, you know, the marijuana criminals, and for us that was just never our experience. And so we always felt like if in order to really change this conversation, we have to be able to put a face on it. And I hesitated to use the analogy until I heard an elder gay man from San Francisco say, it's just like the struggle for sexual freedom. You guys are coming out of the closet. And that has really rung true for us, and I, you know, it was interesting. In the last couple of weeks, I've been on a number of panels with it, you know, at conferences or workshops put on by the, you know, the traditional farming community, and that's been a big part of my advocacy, is really trying to erase this false divide between cannabis growers and farmers, as though it's, you know, not somehow the same thing, and it's been a little disheartening, but also pretty empowering to really start to have these conversations and really start to break down some of these divides and try to, you know, build bridges into the future and, you know, like you said, develop these relationships that really give people a window into who we are, what we do, and why we should be allowed to do it.
You know, these people are really heroes to me and to my community, and frankly, so are all of you for having an open mind and an open heart and all of the work that you're bringing to this. And I thought that in order to honor that, I really wanted to bring their voices to you so you could hear in their own words, you know, what their experience and relationship is with cannabis.
I have the ultimate trust in this plant. Mm. I think that as we get busy trying to be human beings around this plant and trying to work out laws and regulations, trying to learn new therapies, this whole new world, we need to come back to just trusting the plant. She is actually the one that's out there doing the work, and we're just supporting her. So continually when I check in with her and ask her, what message do you want me to bring out to the world? These people are gathering, they want to learn about you. What do you want to share with them? And almost always she reminds me that it's all about love. Mm. That love is what heals people, love is what supports people, love is what creates community and security. And so whenever you're making decisions around the future or around this plant, to remember that it's all about the love.
Voices from Mendocino County. Thank you, everybody.
So I love everything about Mendocino County. It's the prettiest place that I've ever been to, and the people there are so special. And I've actually gotten to go to the farmer's market at Area 101, and it's just, I mean, it's a model for what it should be. So with that, with the Appalachians, because Mendocino, you already have the infrastructure for tourism. You have the wine, you have the beauty, right? And so how do the Appalachians play into not only the tourism and the branding and the marketing of it, but also the protection of it? Because from what I've seen, you guys grow the best cannabis on the planet, and it's craft, it's artisanal, it's premium. And I don't see Mendocino growers getting stomped by big corporate interests, right? Because it's special. So how do the Appalachians play into all of that, into protection and promotion of it?
Well, one of the reasons I really wanted to highlight Voices of Mendocino is because, again, because of the geographical dispersion and, you know, prohibition, we don't really know. We don't have the data, right? So we know it experientially. We can taste it. We can feel it. But we're really moving forward in partnership with other organizations like the International Cannabis Farmers Association to really work to get that research and data, and that's part of why the Appalachians Project is really focused on grassroots outreach, because the knowledge is out there, the genetics are out there, you know, these beautiful strains and all of that. It's 30,000 growers, wow, you know, we don't even know what we're really sitting on, and frankly, we don't have the option to turn into a, you know, commercial producer county, like, say, Humboldt County, for example. And so the way that craft quality combines with tourism and that interface, right, between the public is essential. And so the Appalachians Project really was born out of a desire to protect farmers and take all of the steps that we need to take in order to really identify our value, right, and bring that voice to the world.
Right. Well, I have a question.
Yeah.
Do have other people from, let's say, outside of your county or some more big money names, have they been coming up and getting any of the land or anything like that? Some corporates and stuff like that, other corporations? Have they been buying some of Mendocino County?
Yes, that's happening. That's definitely happening in ways that we know and ways that we don't know. And this is part of why the Appalachians Project is so important, because it is grassroots based. And it's based around protecting and supporting the endogenous cannabis community in Mendocino County, right? And so there's a way that we need to relate with big money, and we need to relate with investors, but we need to first find our voice. If we don't even have the capacity as growers and business owners to really stand for who we are and what we bring to the table, how can we possibly negotiate with a $1 billion company, right? And so that's part of the work, right? It's on a very small grassroots level, it's about getting communities together wherever they feel safe. That may be the Grange in certain communities, it may be someone's private ranch, having the conversation, experiencing the dialogue. I'm in my own sort of process of finding my own voice. And, you know, the prohibition of cannabis has a lot of untold effects, you know, relationally, right? And so that's a really important piece, because we're gonna need funding. We're going to need that support and that money, but we have to do it in a good way, right? I mean, it's scary. It's exciting, it's terrifying, it's all those things at the same time.
Because you don't really have the funding or the money to really compete with them on the same way, on the same level, so you have to figure out some kind of way. And maybe now you've got this rest before everything comes in, but you got to figure out some way to communicate with that piece, or you know what I mean, because that could happen. But they have to figure out. You have to understand you have a value as well, and they're going to have to figure out how to communicate with you, because it's one thing to come and be on the land, but it's another thing to really understand and be in communication and in love with that land, so that what comes out is produced, because
it's
just not a mechanical thing to grow herb, as we all know.
No, and in some ways I think we're fortunate in Mendocino County. There's smaller parcels. Our county government, you know, doesn't want to permit 1 acre grows, and so we're kind of forced to work how we've been working, really, as small craft farmers. And that's where the love is, and that's where the medicine is, right? And so, yes, that's not something you can convey quickly, right? It's a lifestyle thing. It's so much, right? And so we, as a county, need to figure out how we find that language and what those processes are so that we can re-engage and reconnect with the rest of California, with the rest of the world, right? It's a huge coming out for many, many people.
I'll get back to you guys.
Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Janine.